Good morning, Butler family and friends. Happy Sunday. Whatever time that you're seeing this, we want to say that you are welcomed here in the name of our Lord Jesus Christ. Wherever you're from or whatever you're doing right now, God has a word for you. The Lord wants to meet you where you are today. Whether you're walking in the park listening into this, whether you're somewhere kicked up with your feet on the couch, or whether you are sitting watching this solemnly with your family, you are welcomed here and God is going to meet you right where you are. Welcome to church, family.
Brothers and sisters in Christ, I welcome you to this sacred time today. I welcome you in the name of Jesus, the giver and sustainer of life. Hear these words written by Joshua Bowen. When the rain begins to fall and the winds blow, you will not be swept away. For my vine reaches high towards the light and my roots deep into truth. God is the gardener who tends to every need. He prunes each branch that bears fruit and severs every weed. God loved us when we were tiny seeds. God nurtured each blossoming plant. God helped us to mature and grow from seed to fruit-bearing branches. Let us gather as God's people in God's love for God's world. Let us gather as we remember the one who tends us, who recognizes the sound of our names, the one who bends to heal us, who gives up everything for us, whose strength and love holds us. Let us gather to worship God, the one who has created us, who sustains us, who redeems us, who walks beside us in good times, in bad times, and who calls us to be connected so that we might bear good fruit. Let us gather to worship God, who calls us to be connected so that we will not wither away. This is our God. Let us worship God, the one and only true vine.
We are climbing.
Good morning once again, family. I want to invite each and every one of you into a space of prayer, a place where we can express everything that is on our hearts to God, because He cares for you. He cares for each and every one of us. Pray with me. Gracious God, we are so thankful that you have brought us through another week. God, we are thankful that you have allowed us to see another day. God, whether this week has been hard, whether this week has been great, God, you have been faithful in keeping us. So God, we just want to take a time and say thank you for all that you have done for us. But God, we also lift up to you those who are experiencing affliction. God, your word says, cry with those who cry, rejoice with those who rejoice. And at this moment, we want to make time for those who are experiencing a season of mourning, for those who are experiencing a season of pain, for those who may be experiencing a time of sickness. God, whatever it may be, we pray that you would meet them right there in that place. We pray, God, that you would give them peace, that you would give them joy, that you would provide the healing that they need, that you would provide the support that they need. Why don't you just take a minute right now and lift up the name of a loved one, of a friend that you know is in need of prayer. God, we lift up those loved ones, our friends, our family members to you right now. We hold them before you, God, and we trust you. We entrust them into your hands, God. And God, we just pray for your grace to cover them. God, we pray for you to continue to put joy and peace into their hearts. Lord, we also pray for all of those who are experiencing seasons of joy. God, we pray that for those of us who may be experiencing seasons of joy, that we would not keep those seasons to ourselves, but use these moments to encourage others, who may be in a low place. God, we pray for your blessing and your grace over the rest of this service. God, we pray that you would speak through Reverend Pinckney today. God, we pray that you would speak to each and every one of our lives. God, you know that we need to hear from you. So Holy Spirit, open up our hearts so that we may hear, one, what the Spirit of God is saying to your church. Two, God, what you are saying to us as individuals. And three, God, what you are saying to our communities, our families. God, speak to our hearts today. We are listening and we need a word from you. So God, we thank you for your grace and for your blessing over the rest of the service. And God, I just pray for anyone who was listening in, especially those who don't know you, that their hearts would be open to hear your word for them and to see who Jesus is more clearly. We pray for these things in the name of Jesus Christ. Amen.
The scripture lesson is taken from Acts chapter 8, verses 26 through 40. Then an angel of the Lord said to Philip, "Get up and go toward the south, to the road that goes down from Jerusalem to Gaza. This is a wilderness road." So he got up and went. Now there was an Ethiopian eunuch, a court official of the Candace, queen of the Ethiopians, in charge of her entire treasury. He had come to Jerusalem to worship and was returning home. Seated in his chariot, he was reading the prophet Isaiah. Then the Spirit said to Philip, "Go over to the chariot and join it. So Philip ran up to it and heard him reading the prophet Isaiah. He asked, "Do you understand what you are reading?" He replied, "How can I unless someone guides me?" And he invited Philip to get in and sit beside him. Now the passage of the scripture that he was reading was this: "Like a sheep he was led to the slaughter, and like a lamb silent before his shearer, so he does not open his mouth. In his humiliation, justice was denied him. Who can describe his generation? For his life is taken away from the earth. The eunuch asked Philip, "About whom, may I ask, does the prophet say this? About himself or about someone else?" Then Philip began to speak, and starting with this scripture, he proclaimed to him the good news about Jesus. As they were going along the road, they came to some water, and the eunuch said, "Look, here is water. What is to prevent me from being baptized?" He commanded the chariot to stop, and both of them, Philip and the eunuch, went down into the water, and Philip baptized him. When they came up out of the water, the Spirit of the Lord snatched Philip away, and the eunuch saw him no more, and went on his way rejoicing. But Philip found himself at Azotus, and as he was passing through the region, he proclaimed the good news to all the towns until he came to Caesarea. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. 7 through 21. God is love. Beloved, let us love one another, because love is from God. Everyone who loves is born of God and knows God. Whoever does not love does not know God, for God is love. God's love was revealed among us in this way. God sent his only Son into the world so that we may live through him. In this love, not that we love God, but that he loved us and sent his Son to be the atoning sacrifice for our sins. Beloved, since God loved us so much, we ought to love one another. No one has ever seen God. If we love one another, God lives in us, and his love is perfected in us. By this we know that we abide in him and he in us, because he has given us his Spirit. And we have seen and do testify that the Father has sent his Son as the Savior of the world. God abides in those who confess that Jesus is the Son of God, and they abide in God. So we have known and believe the love that God has for us. God is love, and those who abide in love abide in God, and God abides in them. Love has been perfected among us in this, that we may have boldness on the day of judgment, because as he is, so are we in this world. There is no fear in love, but perfect love casts out fear, for fear has to do with punishment, and whoever fears has not reached perfection in love. We love because he first loved us. Those who say, "I love God," and hate his brothers or sisters are liars. For those who do not love a brother or a sister whom they have seen cannot love God whom they have not seen. The commandment we have from him is this: those who love God must love their brothers and sisters also. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God.
John chapter 15, verses 1 through 8. I am the true vine, and my Father is the vine grower. He removes every branch in me that bears no fruit. Every branch that bears fruit, he prunes to make it bear more fruit. You have already been cleansed by the word that I have spoken to you. Abide in me as I abide in you. Just as the branch cannot bear fruit by itself unless it abides in the vine, neither can you unless you abide in me. I am the vine, you are the branches. Those who abide in me and I in them bear much fruit, because apart from me you can do nothing. Whoever does not abide in me is thrown away like a branch and withers. Such branches are gathered, thrown into the fire, and burned. If you abide in me, and my words abide in you, ask for whatever you wish, and it will be done for you. My Father is glorified by this, that you bear much fruit and become my disciples. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God.
As it was in the beginning, yes, now and ever shall be. World without end. Amen. Amen.
Turn your eyes upon Jesus. Look fully his wonderful face, and the things of the earth will grow strangely dim in the light of his glory and grace. Keep me shining, Lord. Keep me shining, Lord, in all I say and do, that the world may see Christ lives in me and learn to love him too.
I come to the garden alone, while the dew is pale on the roses, and the voice I hear burning on my ear, the tone of God. With me, birthday in the garden.
Have you heard it through the true vine? Not the grapevine. Have you heard it through the true vine? In 1967 and 69, one of the classic and memorable R&B hit songs of that era captured the soul of my youth. And it was a song, I heard it through the grapevine. It was a song sung by Marvin Gaye and Gladys Knight and the Pips. It spoke of a ruined relationship, a breakdown in communication, and a shattering bond of trust that resulted in a man expressing in the words of this song a broken heart, a man with a broken spirit, a man with a messed up mind, because he heard through the grapevine that his love had left him. Not only was that song a memorable hit in the music industry back in the day, but it also expresses and outlines the results and consequences when the grapevine becomes the means of misinformation, disinformation, gossip, and rumors that are passed on from one person to the next, and they change in meaning and cause the ruination of relationship. The grapevine communication line symbolizes the rumor mill, the clique communication line, the gossip and the chit-chat chatterbox channel, and the hearsay network that oftentimes is the predominant means of transmitting and communicating. But as Catherine Pulsifer so eloquently said, gossip serves no purpose other than to hear yourself talk. Or Scott Allen, who said, people who judge harshly, criticize, and condemn others through gossip, rumor, or bad word of mouth are setting themselves up for the same unfair trials. Not allowing yourself to get dragged into the grapevine, the gossip network, and talking behind people's backs can be a challenge, but I believe it's an essential part of God's plan and staying connected to the true vine. You see, there's only one person who can give you peace of mind and joy divine. There's only one person who can mend a broken heart and restore a messed up mind. There's only one person who can save you, deliver you, rescue you, and restore you. And his name is Jesus, God's vine, the divine vine, the one who said, I am the true vine, and my Father is the vineyard keeper. I'm here to tell you that when you are attached to the true vine, when you are supported by the true vine, when you are supplemented and associated with the true vine, when you are connected to the true vine, when you are joined to the true vine, you have all you need to produce fine spiritual wine. I heard it through the grapevine is a saying and jargon that was and still is a popular expression used throughout the English-speaking world to refer to unsubstantiated information. The information may be true or it just may be a rumor. The important thing is that the source is not necessarily verified and the information cannot be relied upon as being accurate. Often, while the information may start out as true, it changes as each person recalls only bits and pieces of the original story and add to it. Examples of such, I heard it through the grapevine that Sister Jones was looking for a job and was ready to leave her job, even though Sister Jones had no interest or desire. I heard it through the grapevine that Brother Smith left his wife of 40 years for a young girl. And don't think that the grapevine is not fully operative in the church. I heard it through the grapevine Mr. So-and-so was ready give it up and to talk a bad word and to give up the church. And so to hear something through the grapevine is to pass from person to person information that doesn't measure up to its origin. But I would argue and suggest that there is a better means, method, and manner of communication, interaction, and transmission that is greater, superior, and loftier than the grapevine, and that is the true vine. There is a difference and distinction and deviation between information and communication through the grapevine and revelation, transformation, and interaction that occurs through and in the true vine. You see, beloved, the grapevine is flawed, faulty, fallacious, salacious, and flimsy. It's based on me, myself, and I, but the true vine is centered on God the Father, God the Son, and God the Holy Spirit. The grapevine specializes in he said, she said, and someone said, but the true vine specializes in what the Gospel of John said. In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. The grapevine listens to every Tom, Dick, and Harry, Mary, Jane, and Sue. But those on the true vine listen to the holy word of God, the gospel of good news, and the anointing of the Holy Spirit. The grapevine is unreliable, untrustworthy, fly by night, fickle, false, and frivolous, but the true vine is trustworthy, tried, and true. The grapevine will get you tripped up in trouble, the trivial and the trifling. But the true vine, those who are walking in the true vine, walk by faith and not by sight. They're steadfast, unmovable, always abounding in the work of the Lord. The grapevine likes to blame, make claims, and complain, while the true vine will change you, rearrange you, and exchange your sin-sick soul to a soul saved by grace. The grapevine is tipped off and trips out on allegations, accusations, and denunciations, while the true vine is based on the DNA of God's word spoken of in Hebrews 4:12. For the word of God is quick and powerful, sharper than any two-edged sword, piercing even to the dividing asunder of soul and spirit, and of the joints and marrow, and is a discerner of the thoughts and intentions of the heart. And so I would suggest that the true vine is the way to go if you want to have life in God. And so in John chapter 15, Jesus and his disciples have just celebrated the Passover. As we set up the context of John chapter 15, verse 1 to 8, we have come to the last of the I am statements recorded in John's gospel. Along with the previous statements, when Jesus declared that he was the way, the truth, and the life, these comments follow their intimate time in the upper room. Jesus and the disciples are at this moment making their way to the Garden of Gethsemane. In a very short time, Jesus will be arrested and taken to stand before the high priest and Sanhedrin. Jesus has already said, I am the light of the world. I am the bread of life. I am the way. I am the door. Now, before his death, he tells his beloved disciples, I am the true vine. In this key point in his ministry, Christ unveils and discloses a pivotal theological theme that reflects the expression of God's design for relationship with God and fruitfulness in God. Jesus equated kingdom reality to a vine and helps us explore the dynamic relationship between Jesus Christ and God, Jesus Christ and his disciples, and Jesus Christ, God, and all who believe and put their trust in him for generations to come. The disciples had just left Jerusalem, And we're heading down the Kidron Valley and up the slope of the Mount of Olives to the Garden of Gethsemane. Without a doubt, the disciples were struggling to comprehend the magnificent truths that Jesus had taught them in the upper room. But now they are saddened by his statements. And in those statements, the seeds of uncertainty about their future arise. The question I want to ask you today is, what do you do when your future is unclear? Who do you turn to when your world is upside down? Who do you listen to when you need answers to difficult questions? When your life is at stake, where do you turn for advice? Do you go to the grapevine or do you go to the true vine? I'm a witness that when you need an answer, the true vine is the best place to latch on to. When you need counsel, advice, and guidance, or a recommendation and response to your situation, go to the true vine, not the grapevine. Because the true vine will give you hope for tomorrow and joy in the time of sorrow. The true vine is a way maker, heart fixer, mind regulator, and burden bearer. Do I have a witness here? When I am in trouble and my back is against the wall, I don't call up the grapevine. I go to the true vine because he may not come when you want him, but he's always right on time. And so, as we enter that scene with Jesus and his disciples, I can imagine that as they came close to a cluster of vines full of promise for the coming harvest, he spoke these words that echo through the corridor of eternity. He said, "I am the true vine, and my Father is the vineyard keeper." He brings a new, radical, and comprehensive, sweeping redirection of what it means to be in relationship, what it means to rely, and what it means to have the resources, and what it means to respond to Jesus Christ, the true vine, and to produce fruit as a result of his teaching. The main point made here is that Israel had been the vine, and all who wanted to worship the true God had to be grafted to it. But now, in Christ and his teaching, we have become attached to the true vine. In terms of how to be joined into right relationship with God. Although we are years removed from those ancient words that Jesus spoke at that fateful moment of divine insight, instruction, and information, they remain still today powerful and profound for the contemporary believer. You see, beloved, there is an eternal truth that we must consider and reflect upon as we embrace these words. And so, as we ponder the meaning, message, and divine messenger we have in Jesus Christ, we do so from the perspective of Jesus' declaration, "I am the true vine." We must consider this statement in terms of our relationship, our resources, and our reliance on God. We must look at this as we apply the concepts of horticulture, agriculture, and gardening expressed in planting, pruning, producing, and the produce that God wants us to be as good fruit. We must examine the connection of our call, our charge, and our commission as disciples in Christ to understand how God is seeding and God is the source and God is the substance and God is the sustenance and God is the supply and the supplier of all we need in this season we are in. And so amid all of the issues and the drama and the chaos, confusion, and calamity that we are dealing with in these challenging times, we must ask ourselves the question, have you heard not through the grapevine, but through the true vine? And so as we reflect and survey the landscape of the season we're in, what are we to hear? I heard through the true vine that God is the planter. God is the pruner. God is the provider. God is the protector. And God is the producer. And I heard through the true vine, he said, I am the vine, you are the branches. He who abides in me and I in him bear much fruit, for without me you can do nothing. And so that's the first point I want to make. Jesus said he is the true vine, and he is the one that gives life, and he is the one that enables a branch from the vine to produce fruit. And so without him, we can do nothing, we can produce nothing, and only through him can we bear fruit. And without him, we will not produce fruit and will be thrown away. And so it is imperative that we stay in relationship with the true vine. It is essential that we rely on the true vine. It is vital that we remain in connection with the true vine as our resource to produce and bear fruit. The word abide is the verb form of dwelling place. It is only by abiding in him, dwelling in him, staying connected to Christ and remaining attached to him that our relationship with him grows and we're able to do godly things and produce and bear fruit. If we are not connected to the true vine by and through the word of the Lord, we may grow, but we may not grow any fruit. You know, sadly, I must say that many of us, even in the church, are connected to the vine, but are not bearing fruit. Maybe it's because of fear. Maybe it's because of jealousy and envy. Maybe it's because of power plays and power tricks and politics. I'm here to say, if you're not going to bear fruit while connected to the true vine, you are in trouble. And you may find yourself cut out from the vine. But if you're going to bear fruit while connected to the true vine, You have to have the mind of Christ, the heart of Christ, the faith in Christ, and the nature of Christ. And the only way you can stay clean and walk right is to abide in Him and He in you. That's why our prayer should be just a closer walk with Thee. Grant it, Jesus, if you please, daily walking close to Thee. Let it be, dear Lord, let it be. I like that second verse. It says, I am weak, but Thou art strong. Jesus, keep me from all wrong. I'll be satisfied just as long as I can walk, dear Lord, close to Thee. Then not only must we abide in Him and He in us, the second verse says, He, that is the vineyard keeper, removes any of his branches that don't produce fruit, and he trims any branch that produces fruit so that it will produce even more fruit. Beloved, we are saved by grace through faith to produce fruit. Fruit is produced in the way we love God with all our hearts, our minds, our souls, and our spirit, and our neighbor as ourselves. Fruit is produced when we make disciples for Jesus Christ, baptizing in the name of the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Fruit is produced when we engage in the work of kingdom building, lift up the name of Jesus, and stand on the promises of God. Fruit is produced when we love one another as God has loved us. We cannot produce fruit on our own. Pruning is a necessary part of our growth in the Lord. Pruning is a familiar image with both negative and positive connotation. The negative would be a dried branch lacking the vital sap and sustenance to bear fruit. This branch, the vine grower cuts off and tosses aside. On the other hand, positive pruning is when the vine grower prunes a healthy, living branch, not as a hostile act, rather as a way of enabling that branch to grow more and bear much fruit. And so we cannot produce fruit unless the vineyard keeper is working on us. He's the one who is the source of our sustenance. He's the one who is the supplier of our needs. That's why Philippians 4:19 says, God will supply all your needs according to His riches and glory. If He cleans you up, if God has pruned you, if God has to cut some leaves so that you don't get too full of yourself or don't get too high and mighty and think that it's all about you when in reality it's all about God, don't be afraid of the pruning and trimming. Sometimes God has to do some pruning so that you don't think that you can produce fruit without God. Left to ourselves, we cannot make all the changes we need. Left to ourselves, we'll fall from the vine. But if God is pruning us, if God is remaking us, if God is having His way with us, then everything will work out all right. Jesus says that God in love prunes us, corrects us, cleans us, chastens us, and tries us so that we can become more fruitful. Oh, church, I'm so glad that we're in God's hands. I'm glad that we're in God's hands and not in church folk hands, because God knows what's best for us. He will do what God must do to make us yield good fruit. And so, beloved, the final essence of this scripture and theme in this message is all about who, how, what, and where we are to stay connected. You see, beloved, the connection to the true vine is the pathway to eternity. The connection to the true vine is the way to the storehouse of God's blessings. The connection to the true vine gives us access to grace through faith. And this is not our own doing. It's the gift of God. Have you heard it? Through the true vine means staying connected through prayer. Have you heard it? Through the true vine means staying connected through fellowship, worship, discipleship, and relationship with fellow believers who are one in the Spirit and one in the Lord. Have you heard it? Through the true vine means staying connected by studying God's word, because the word of God is a lamp unto our feet and a light unto our path. Have you heard it? Through the true vine means staying connected by understanding that a charge to keep we have, a God to glorify, a never dying soul to save and fitted for the sky, to serve this present age, our calling to fulfill. Oh, may it all our powers engage to do our master's will. I can talk about many who have heard it through the grapevine, but I'd rather talk about those who have heard it through the true vine. Martin Luther King heard it through the true vine when he said, "We've got some difficult days ahead, but it doesn't matter to me now because I've been to the mountaintop. And I don't mind like anybody. I would like to live a long life. Longevity has its place, but I'm not concerned about it now. I just want to do God's will. And he's allowed me to go up to the mountain and to look over, and I've seen the promised land. I may not get there with you, but one day we as a people will get to the promised land. So I'm happy tonight. I'm not worried about anything. I'm not fearing any man. Mine eyes have seen the glory of the coming of the Lord." John Newton heard it, not through the grapevine, but through the true vine. And that prompted him to say, "Amazing grace, how sweet the sound that saved a wretch like me. I once was lost, but now I'm found. Was blind, but now I see." The Apostle Paul heard it not through the grapevine, but through the true vine on the road to Damascus. And when he heard it, he said, "If God is for us, who can be against us? He who did not withhold his own son, but gave him up for us all, will he not with him also give us everything else? Who will bring any charge against God's elect? It is God who justifies. Who is to condemn? It is Christ Jesus who died. Yes, who was raised, who is at the right hand of God and intercedes for us? Who shall separate us from the love of Christ? Oh, beloved, the prophecy of Isaiah is a word through the true vine, not the grapevine. Isaiah 40, 28, have you not known? Have you not heard? The Lord is the everlasting God, the creator of the ends of the earth. He does not faint or grow weary. His understanding, hallelujah, is unsearchable. He gives power to the faint, and to him who has no might, he increases strength. Even youth shall faint and be weary, and young men shall fall exhausted. But they, glory to God, they that wait upon the Lord shall renew their strength. They will mount up on wings like eagles. They shall run and not get weary. They shall walk and not faint. Fanny Crosby heard it through the grapevine and wrote over 8,000 hymns and gospel songs and over 1,000 poems. But the one that helps me the most to hear it through the true vine is this: blessed assurance, Jesus is mine. Oh, what a foretaste of glory divine, heir of salvation, purchase of God, born of his spirit, washed in his blood. This, praise his name, this is my story. This is my song, praising my Savior all the day long. And now, beloved, because I've heard through the true vine, I can say, because he lives, I can face tomorrow. Because he lives, all fear is gone. Because I know who holds my future, and life is worth the living. All because he lives. And that's the good news. That's the good news, church, that I've heard through the true vine. Amen. Let us pray. Gracious and loving God, we thank you. We thank you that we can once more come to you with a blessed assurance in the words that you have spoken. I am the true vine, and my Father is the vineyard keeper. And because of that, we can abide in you and you in us. Because of that, we can be planted. We can be pruned. We can be protected, and we can be producers of good fruit because of a God who's omnipotent, a God who's omniscient, a God who's omnipresent. That means he's all powerful, all knowing, and all present. And so, it's all right if sometimes you have to work on us, Lord, by pruning us, by cutting off some leaves that are drying out. But then it is our prayer that at the end of the day, we'll stay connected. Stay connected and join to the true vine, who is the source, who is the substance, who is the sustenance, who is the supply, and who is the supplier of all our needs, according to his riches in glory, in Christ Jesus. Amen. And now we are invited to join in the service of communion. For those who have their hymnal, please turn to the service of word and table number 2, that we may follow along. Christ our Lord invites to his table all who love him, who earnestly repent of their sin and seek to live in peace with one another. Therefore, let us confess our sin before God and one another. Let us pray. Merciful God, we confess that we have not loved you with our whole heart. We have failed to be an obedient church. We have not done your will. We have broken your law. We have rebelled against your love. We have not loved our neighbors, and we have not heard the cry of the needy. Forgive us, we pray. Free us for joyful obedience through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Hear the good news. Christ died for us while we were yet sinners. That proves God's love toward us. In the name of Jesus Christ, you are forgiven. In the name of Jesus Christ, you are forgiven. Glory to God. Amen. So as forgiven and reconciled people, I invite you to offer signs of love, signs that you have heard it through the true vine. Peace, love, peace, love. May God bless you. Let us join now in the great thanksgiving. The Lord be with you and also with you. Lift up your hearts. We lift them up to the Lord. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. It is right to give our thanks and praise. It is right and a good and joyful thing, always and everywhere, to give thanks to you, Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. And so with your people on earth and all the company of heaven, we praise your name and join their unending hymn. Holy, holy, holy Lord, God of power and might, heaven and earth are full of your glory. Hosanna in the highest. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest. Holy are you, and blessed is your Son, Jesus Christ. By the baptism of his suffering, death, and resurrection, you gave birth to your church, delivered us from slavery to sin and death, and made with us a new covenant by water and the Spirit. On the night in which he gave himself up for us, he took bread, gave thanks to you, broke the bread, gave it to his disciples, and said, "Take, eat. This is my body, which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." When the supper was over, he took the cup, gave thanks to you, gave it to his disciples, and said, "Drink from this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me." And so, in remembrance of these, your mighty acts in Jesus Christ, we offer ourselves in praise and thanksgiving as a holy and living sacrifice in union with Christ's offering for us as we proclaim the mystery of faith. Christ has died. Christ is risen. Christ will come again. Pour out your Holy Spirit on us gathered here and on these gifts of bread and wine. Make them be for us the body and blood of Christ, that we may be for the world the body of Christ, redeemed by his blood. By your Spirit, make us one with Christ, one with each other, and one in ministry to all the world until Christ comes in final victory and we feast at his heavenly banquet. Through your Son, Jesus Christ, with the Holy Spirit, in your holy church, all honor and glory is yours, Almighty Father, now and forever. And now, with the confidence of children of God, let us join in the prayer our Lord has taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come. Thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. At your abode, your residence, or your home, you are invited to share in the Lord's Supper by using elements that are appropriate and for which you are comfortable, that we may join together in this love feast as we remember the sacrifice of love made by our Savior and Redeemer, Jesus Christ, our Lord. This is the body of Christ that was broken for you. This is the cup of the new covenant, the blood of Christ that was shed for you. The body of Christ that was given for you. Take and eat. Feed in your hearts with thanksgiving. The blood of Christ that was shed for you. Drink all of this and be thankful. And now let us join in the prayer. Eternal God, we give you thanks for this holy mystery in which you have given yourself to us. Grant that we may go into the world in the strength of your Spirit to give ourselves to others. In the name of Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen.
Happy Sunday once again, family. I hope that you enjoyed the message today. I hope that you more than enjoyed it. I pray that God met you right where you are, that you not only could hear what God had to say to you, not through the grapevine, not through a secondary means, but through the true vine, through God in Christ speaking to you. If God was speaking to you today, saying that it's time for you to become a disciple of Christ, I want to encourage you not to waste this time, not to waste this moment, but to act on it. God loves you and he wants to be in relationship with you. And he wants you to be in right relationship with him. So if you have questions today about how to become a disciple of Christ or what it means to become a disciple of Christ, we want you to reach out to us. Butler Memorial UMC has many pastors, many leaders, many congregants who would love to help walk you through what it means to be a disciple of Christ. And if you are someone who has already been on the journey of discipleship, that you're still walking with Christ, but you don't have a family right now to walk with, God doesn't want to leave you alone. He doesn't want you walking by yourself. But he calls us into the church because we all need encouragement. We all need help. We all need accountability to walk with Christ, to be on this path of discipleship. So we want to invite you into this family. If you are interested in being a part of Butler Memorial UMC or have any questions about this church, please, we encourage you to contact us as well. Following today's benediction, please stay tuned for the announcements. All right, see you guys.
As we close out this worship experience today, we thank God for all who have joined us across the world. We thank God for our church family, and we pray for those who are sick and infirmed in hospital rooms or nursing homes. Know that you've heard it from the true vine, that God loves you, God cares for you, and that his love, even in the midst of your affliction, is such to say that there is a balm in Gilead to heal the sin-sick soul. There is a balm in Gilead to make the wounded whole. His sacrifice and suffering is so great that there is power, wondrous working power in the blood of the Lamb. Gracious God, we thank you for the gifts, the contributions, the tithes, and the offerings of those who continue to give lovingly, give generously, and give sacrificially. Bless them and consecrate them to the work of kingdom building, that the name of Jesus may be lifted, that souls may be changed and transformed, and that your kingdom may come. And now bless us as we depart, that we may depart in your love and peace. And so go forth in peace. And may the grace of the Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the sweet communion of the Holy Spirit rest and abide with you now and always. Amen.
Butler Memorial UMC invites all children and youth to Sunday school at 2 p.m. today on Zoom. The meeting ID is 602-8852-997. The access code is 3CTA3A. Prayer changes things. Join us on the prayer line Tuesday morning at 10 p.m. On Wednesdays, you can also join us for Bible study at 11 a.m. For the prayer line as well as the Bible study, dial 605-313-5109. The access code is 630735. The next senior adult meeting will be held on Tuesday, May 11th at 11:30 a.m. The meeting will also be on free conference call. Start Thursdays with the Word. The Early Risers Group is studying the Book of Luke. You can connect by dialing 515-603-3145 and using access code 160319. The time of the meeting is 6 a.m. on Thursday mornings. Join us for fellowship hour on Thursday evenings from 7 to 8 p.m. All are welcome. Dial 717-275-8940. Access code 956-9417. The church hours of operation are Monday 8 a.m. to 2 p.m., Thursday 8 a.m. to 2 p.m., and Friday 9 a.m. to 5 p.m. You can also leave a message and your call will be acknowledged. Persons wishing to conduct meetings using free conference call are being asked to contact the church office to make the arrangement. This is in order to avoid conflicting meeting schedules. The book club is reading The Cross and the Lynching Tree by James Cone. The next meeting will be on Monday, June 7th at 7:30 p.m. The church will celebrate its 109th anniversary on May 22nd, 2021 at 2 p.m. The theme is We've Come This Far by Faith, based on 2 Corinthians 5:7. Join us on Zoom. Dial in at 646-558-8650 with meeting ID 989-6606-9529. The anniversary committee will be holding a fundraiser dinner on May 7th, 2021 from 3 p.m. to 7 p.m. Please call Sister Joyce White at 646-456-3602 to place your order. Scholarship applications for undergraduate and graduate students for 2021-2022 academic year are now available. The documents can be downloaded from the church website, butlermemorialumc.com, or applicants can contact the church office at 718-653-0358. The deadline for submission is May 30th, 2021. For questions or additional information, please reach out to Sister Erica Mills, Scholarship Committee Chairperson, or Brother Philip Irons, Scholarship Committee Co-Chairperson. The church has an open position for a Director of Music. Applicants should have a bachelor's degree with a music major or minor and or a minimum of 3 years related experience. Qualified applicants can submit their CV to butlerspprc@gmail.com. Your vote matters. New York City will use ranked choice voting in the upcoming election. You can rank up to 5 candidates in order of preference instead of choosing just one. Early voting will be held from June 12th through June 20th. The deadline to request an absentee ballot is June 15th. Absentee ballots must be mailed in by June 22nd. Primary election day will be on Tuesday, June 22nd, 2021. Please hold the date. The United Methodist Men and United Methodist Women, in collaboration with the Office of Council Member Riley, will sponsor an educational session on ranked choice voting on Saturday, May 29th at 10 a.m. There will be a special church conference on May 11th, 7:30 p.m. for the selection of 2 trustees. United Methodist Women will be meeting on Saturday, May 8th at 10 a.m. You are invited to join them to put your faith, hope, and love into action. The meeting will be held on free conference call. Let us lift up those who are in need of healing. George Bell, husband of Sister Velma Bell, Martha Phillips, Castles Green, and Winifred McLean. Let us be in prayer for those who are mourning. Sister Paulette Gordon lost her father, Sylvester Gordon, Sister Carol Malcolm Charles, who recently lost a brother, has now lost her sister, Lorraine Atkinson. Sister Rebecca Phillips lost a great aunt, and Sister Eunice Kirkpatrick, a niece. As always, we hope you enjoyed the service today. Please join us again next week. You can join the service live on Zoom, YouTube, or Facebook Live at 10 a.m. The worship service is also available on Zoom at 12 p.m. Stay safe, and may God continue to richly bless each and every one of you. Goodbye.
Oh,